Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Steve Gregorian. I'm the Chief Operating Officer of the Detroit Economic Club, and I'd like to welcome you to today's meeting. If you've been with us before, you know we like to start on time and end on time, but I wanted to let you know that our normal start time, or normal end time today, will be our 1:35, 5 minutes later. So thank you for that. Please take a moment, silence your cell phones, so we do not disturb the program, and then please stand and join me as we uphold the 78-year tradition of starting our meetings with the Pledge of Allegiance. The flag is to my right.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Kindly remain standing as our invocation today will be delivered by Reverend Daniel Shen, pastor of the Metro Detroit Chinese Alliance Church.
Let us pray. God, you are the Lord and you are the King. You have said, let not the wise man boast of his wisdom, or the strong man boast of his strength, or the rich man boast of his riches, but let him who boast about this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord, who exercise kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For in this I delight. So we pray that may this prayer of gratefulness for the meal and our asking for your blessing upon the meal be a small token showing our honoring you as the Lord and King. May our talk and deed reflect your kindness, justice, and righteousness. And we pray in the name of the King's Son. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend. Please be seated. We'd like to take a quick moment and welcome an elected official that we're very happy to have with us today, Madam Secretary of State Ruth Johnson, over here to my left. Thanks for being with us. And a couple of quick thank yous. I want to thank business leaders from Michigan, Doug, Sabrina, and Kelly, for all your work making this happen. Thank you and letting us have this event. Really appreciate that. Thank you. And also, thank you to Bruce, the Brookings Institution, and Detroit Public TV, who are webcasting this program for us live. So if you're watching from your computer at home or office and eating your peanut butter sandwich, welcome in. And we'd love to see you and have you join us at some point as well. And then a third really quick welcome, thank you, I should say, is a team that I work with every day, the DEC staff. We have put together four amazing programs in the last 2 weeks. I think I heard a little bit about some tiny meeting at a football field tomorrow, but we've been working hard on that. But I want the DEC staff just to wave their hands and say hello. Thank you. As many of you are aware, our student outreach program is a cornerstone of the Detroit Economic Club, and today was no exception. We were lucky enough to host 6 high school and college groups, courtesy of our generous corporate sponsors. They had a chance to spend some time today with our distinguished panel, and they asked some pretty tough questions, so we had some fun in there. And I want to acknowledge the students and their sponsors now. So with us today is Wayne State University, sponsored by Beth Dryden and the folks at Charter One. Two groups of students from Divine Child High School, sponsored by Jim from PVS Chemicals, thank you, and Andra from Dakota Systems, thank you, Andra and Jim. Students from the Entrepreneurial Training Program at Eastern Michigan University are here today. Thank you, Jacqueline Young and the folks at DTE Energy. IT Technical Institute is here today, compliments of the Detroit Auto Dealers Association. And Hamtramck High School is here today. Thank you, Amy and Kevin from the MEDC. So students and sponsors, please rise so we can properly thank you and welcome you. So on your table is our season lineup. I'll be really quick. I want you to take a look at that. I hope you can join us tomorrow at Ford Field for 1,200 people as we host Governor Romney. And also hope you can be with us on March 6th when we've got the pleasure of hosting Chairman Fred Hochberg, who is the Chairman of the Export-Import Bank of the United States. And this next meeting in March, I want all the ladies to pay attention. We're hosting the CEO of Burberry on March 20th, and this is your opportunity to tell your husband you got to go shopping, because you can't show up in something other than Burberry with the CEO of Burberry. So hope you can join us at any of those upcoming meetings. Membership, real quick. If you're not a member, great people, great events. It's tax deductible. Go to our website. You can join econclub.org. And then the final thing, and I'll get off stage, is these blue question cards on your table. Trademark of the Detroit Economic Club certainly is the questions and answers session that we'll have at the end of the panel program. Go ahead and write your questions down. Hold them up. Our staff will collect them, and we'll get them into the right hands. And that's a person we're about to put to work. And that is Mr. Hans Werner Kaas, our presiding officer for today. Hans Werner is the director at McKinsey & Company and a board member of the Detroit Economic Club. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Hans Werner Kaas.
Thank you, Steve. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I have the privilege today of introducing to you today's panel. Starting from your left, Jim Nicholson. Jim is President and Chief Executive Officer of Detroit-based PVS Chemicals. Mr. Nicholson earned his BA in economics from Stanford University in 1965 and his MBA from the University of Chicago in 1967. In 1968, he received a Master of Science degree in economics from the London School of Economics. He became President and Chief Executive Officer of PVS Chemicals in 1979. Mr. Nicholson is widely known for his civic and charitable activities. He currently serves on many boards too, numerous to list, including the Detroit Economic Club. Mr. Nicholson also serves as the Chairman of Business Leaders for Michigan. Welcome, Jim. Bruce Katz. Bruce is the Vice President at the Brookings Institution and Founding Director of the Brookings Metropolitan Policy Program, which aims to provide decision makers in the public, corporate, and civic sectors with policy ideas for improving the health and prosperity of cities and metropolitan areas. Bruce is a graduate of Brown University and Yale Law School. After the 2008 presidential election, Bruce co-led the Housing and Urban Transition team for the Obama administration and served as a senior advisor to new Secretary of HUD, Secretary Sean Donovan, for the first 100 days of the administration. Bruce is also a visiting professor at the London School of Economics. Before joining Brookings, Bruce served as chief of staff of Henry Cisneros, former secretary of the U.S. Department of HUD. Welcome, Bruce. Doug Rothwell. Doug has worked as an executive in the public, private, and nonprofit sectors, having worked for three state governors and two Fortune 500 companies. As president and CEO of Business Leaders for Michigan, a business roundtable of the state's top 80 CEOs, he has led efforts to make Michigan a top 10 state for job, economic, and personal income growth through state policy changes, privately led economic development initiatives. Prior to his current position, Doug held executive roles with organizations such as Detroit Renaissance, General Motors, and the Michigan Economic Development Corporation. Doug holds a Master's of Public Administration degree from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, a Bachelor of Arts degree from the University of Delaware, and attended the John F. Kennedy School residential program for senior executives in state and local government at Harvard University. Welcome, Doug. John Gallagher. Our moderator today is John Gallagher of the Detroit Free Press. Mr. Gallagher is a veteran journalist and author whose latest book, Reimagining Detroit, Opportunities for Redefining an American City, was named by the Huffington Post as among the best social and political books of 2010. John is a native of New York City. He joined the Detroit Free Press in 1987 to cover urban and economic redevelopment efforts in Detroit and Michigan, a post which he still holds. His other books include Great Architecture of Michigan and as co-author, AIA Detroit, the American Institute of Architects' Guide to Detroit Architecture. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in a warm Detroit Economic Club welcome for our distinguished panel. I would like now to invite Jim to get us started. Thank you, Jim.
Thanks to Hans Werner, Southeast Michigan accent that he has. It's not often you'll have to eat lunch with two graduates of the London School of Economics. Bruce and I were sitting there, and I don't think either one of us knew that we were distinguished graduates of such a school. He's undoubtedly more distinguished than I was. I just passed. So let me tell you a little about Business Leaders for Michigan. We're a group, as Hans Werner said, of about 80 CEOs from across the state. And we're dedicated to making Michigan a top 10 state for job growth, for economic growth, and for personal income growth. Our businesses contribute almost 25% of the state's GDP and provide over 320,000 jobs in Michigan. We generate just over $1 trillion, that's with a T, trillion dollars in annual revenue, and we serve more than 135,000 college students. We are clearly invested in this state. Our businesses, our families, and our employees are here. As most of you know, the primary focus of Business Leaders for Michigan since its inception has been the implementation of the Michigan Turnaround Plan. That plan, which we just updated last month, identifies six steps to get our state on a path to prosperity and make Michigan a top 10 state again. A great deal of progress was made in the past year to move Michigan forward, and we were pleased that many of the changes were aligned with the plan that we put forward. One of the six steps in the plan recognizes the importance of accelerating the growth of Michigan's cities and metro regions as they disproportionately drive the state's economy. So to help move this issue forward, we hired public sector consultants, and they, in partnership with the Brookings Institution, spent the last year developing a strategy the state could utilize. Like the rest of our work, they based their recommendations on facts. They conducted research, benchmarked our major metro areas, met with dozens of stakeholders, and compiled and analyzed information to develop the strategy for us. This proposal is an urban and metropolitan strategy that recognizes cities do not stand alone as islands within their regions. Specifically, it identifies where our metro areas stand compared to their peers across the country, highlights their assets, and recommends actions the state can take to help facilitate their growth. I'm now going to turn this over to Bruce, fellow graduate, to go through our program.
Okay, let's see if we can move the technology. Perfect. Thank you for that introduction, and thanks to Business Leaders for Michigan for working with us, with public sector consultants, and thanks to the Kresge, Mott, Fry, and Rockefeller Foundations for supporting us. I'm going to make three points today. The first sets the context for this report. The United States must build a next economy and enable a different kind of growth in the next decade. And that's because the Great Recession was a wake-up call for this country. We lost 8.8 million jobs, and we've only regained about 36% of those during the recovery over the past 2 years. Now, during that recession, this state lost about 403,000 jobs. And while that loss is significant, it tells only part of the story. Between April 2000 and December of 2009, Michigan lost over 860,000 jobs. And to date, the state has regained about 12% of those jobs lost during the past decade. For both the nation and the state, the question is, how do you create more jobs and how do you create better jobs? Now, in the wake of that recession, a growing chorus of business leaders and economists from around the country have made the following proposition. We need a different kind of growth model. We need a next economy, an economy that is fueled by innovation, both ideas and manufacturing, powered by low carbon, driven by exports and global engagement, and rich with opportunity. Now, why innovation? Because economic growth must be driven not just by the generation of ideas, but by the interplay of invention, commercialization, and yes, manufacturing. Manufacturing drives innovation in the United States. It accounts for 35% of the nation's engineers, 68% of industry-funded R&D, and 90% of all patents in this country. Why low carbon? Because the United States must be at the vanguard of the clean economy, which is the next industrial revolution with profound implications for companies, cities, and consumers. Why exports? Because post-recession, market demand for quality products and services is disproportionately coming from abroad, particularly those countries like Brazil, India, and China that are rapidly urbanizing and industrializing. And finally, why opportunity? Because if we build an economy that is more productive, innovation, and export-oriented, then working families will be able to earn wages sufficient to attain a middle-class life. Now, that macro vision literally comes to ground in the nation's 100 top metropolitan areas, which comprise only 12% of the landmass of this country, but house two-thirds of the population and generate three-quarters of our GDP. And that's because these communities concentrate and agglomerate the nation's firms, our talented workers, our risk-taking entrepreneurs, and the ecosystems of universities, community colleges, and business associations that drive modern economies. So that leads to my second point. Michigan and its metros have real strengths in this next economy. You are a metro state. Your 14 metro areas are home to 82% of your population, 84% of exports, 85% of the state's GDP, and 85% of science and engineering jobs. Now, let's just briefly review what a metro area is. The Detroit metropolitan area is a six-county metro, including, obviously, the core city of Detroit, its surrounding suburban counties, such as Wayne, Oakland, and Macomb, and the exurban counties of Livingston, Lapeer, and St. Clair. That's the true geography. So how do your metros fare in the next economy? On innovations, patent, particularly from the manufacturing sector, is a pretty good indicator of performance. Six Michigan metros had a higher number of patents per 1,000 workers from 2001 to 2010 than the average U.S. metro area. 90% of your state's high-tech industry employment, 80% of your advanced manufacturing are in your metro areas. Low-carbon economy, disproportionately manufacturing and innovation-oriented. Out of the 100 largest metros, Detroit ranks fourth nationally in electric vehicle technology specialization. Grand Rapids ranks second in green consumer product specialization. And half of your metros have more or the same share of clean economy jobs as a percentage of their total employment than the national average of 2%. Michigan's metros are exceptional at producing goods and providing services that are in demand abroad. Detroit is first among the top 20 metros in terms of export intensity. That's the share of its output that is exported, and Grand Rapids ranks eighth among the top 100 metros. The 13 of your 14 metro areas are more export intense than the U.S. average. So those strengths in production, innovation, and exports have helped lead Michigan's strong recovery. You've had the second strongest recovery in the United States, led at least in part by the rebounding of your manufacturing base. Your state has a budget surplus of $457 million this past year, as state revenues grew for the first time since 2000. Your unemployment rate, while still above the national average, declined from a peak of 14.1% in 2009 to 9.3% in December of 2011. Now, we don't want to ignore the severe challenges that are faced by your cities and your metropolitan areas. One of them is the slow growth of your working age population in many of your metros. Of Michigan's 14 metros, 13 grew more slowly than the national average of 10.7% over the past decade, while the working age population actually declined in four of those metros. But this report focuses on the assets and the strengths of this state and how to leverage and build them. So that's my final point. You need a new urban and metropolitan strategy to power the state. Now, in the past year, Governor Snyder has successfully pushed a number of policies that have helped to strengthen your economic position. The overhauled emergency financial manager law has helped to stabilize city finances throughout the state. Your Michigan export program will help expand the reach of goods and services produced in Michigan to global markets. The governor's transportation vision, articulated in his special message last October, will focus state resources on transformative infrastructure investments. But given your strengths, we recommend the state do three things to move from an already strong recovery into a new era of shared prosperity. First, strengthen the link between innovation and manufacturing so you can increase regional exports and attract global investments. Second, support strong regional systems to train existing workers and welcome new ones to fuel economic growth. And finally, make transformative investments that leverage the distinct assets, particularly of your central cities, to transform regional economies. Now, in the first goal, there are three recommendations: to reorient the 21st Century Jobs Fund, to bolster exports, to attract foreign direct investment. Let me expand on the first recommendation, which is that the state shift the emphasis of the 21st Century Jobs Fund from primarily funding individual companies to providing a platform to help small and medium-sized manufacturing firms and place them at the cutting edge of technological advances and product innovation. Our specific suggestion: create a network of advanced manufacturing centers that help small and medium-sized firms crack the code on technology barriers. For example, joining materials to create new lightweight sustainable products that are in demand by business and by consumers trying to cut energy costs. This is a new kind of innovation infrastructure that provides small and medium-sized firms the applied engineering problem solving that they can't do by themselves. This new infrastructure should not be an add-on. It should be built in close collaboration with the existing stakeholders in the manufacturing space. Second goal, also three recommendations: reform your state workforce strategies, and I know Doug will talk about this, advocate changes to federal workforce laws, and help skilled immigrants obtain state credentials. Now, I want to expand on that last recommendation. Here's your challenge. Michigan's metros have very few foreign-born residents, although those foreign-born residents who are here show impressive educational attainment when compared to immigrants nationwide. These highly educated immigrants are a major resource for this state as you seek to grow your economy, if they can make use of the skills and education they bring with them to this country. So there's a variety of actions that states can take: provide guidance on how to secure a professional license, address known barriers, and tailor job training programs to immigrants with professional experience. Absolutely critical. Final goal: two recommendations to build on the special assets of your cities and your metros. Support a small number of metro-led industry clusters. Designate 1 to 3 new urban innovation districts. Let me dwell on the past one because it's absolutely fundamental. Innovation districts use the presence of anchor institutions, cultural institutions, distinctive and historic buildings and waterfronts to drive the growth of creative and innovative firms in places that are attractive, compelling, and livable. This is the next generation of city building, metro building in the United States. You have a rich platform to build from, whether it's the Van Andel Institute in Grand Rapids, or the Flint Waterfront, or the grand design of the Guardian Building and the Detroit Institute of Arts. In our view, Midtown and downtown Detroit could be one of the nation's leading urban innovation districts. A block from where we are eating today at the Motor City Casino Hotel, this area contains a large share of the city's most important economic and cultural assets. Midtown alone packs 24,000 residents, 45,000 employees, and 32,000 college students into 1.5 square miles. In order to leverage those assets, we think the state should align existing financial, technical, and regulatory resources to focus on site-specific development efforts and broader infrastructure needs. Now, that obviously implicates MEDC and your housing agency, but it also implicates your Department of Transportation, Licensing and Regulatory Affairs, Environmental Quality, Natural Resources. All these agencies and the resources and policies they bring play a role, overt or subtle, in the remaking of the city. Let me conclude where I began. The U.S. economy is shifting in ways post-recession that play to the strengths of this state and your cities and metropolitan areas. Your innovative legacy, your export orientation, the rich mix of global companies, entrepreneurs, advanced research institutions, philanthropic leadership. You are a state with deep ties and links and relationships with both the mature economies of the world and the growing economies of the world. This could be a Michigan moment if you seize it. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. I want to first of all express my thanks to the many people in this room that I know are here today that helped us put this report together. You didn't get singled out because there's too many of you, but recognize that we appreciate the work that you did. And second, I also want to thank Sabrina Keeley on our group, because Sabrina, you got this project over the finish line for us, so thanks for your help. As Jim mentioned, developing and implementing an urban strategy is one of six steps in the Michigan Turnaround Plan that Business Leaders for Michigan developed. An urban strategy can't be executed in isolation. We need all of the steps to be successful to accelerate growth. Just as there's no silver bullet to turning around Michigan's economy, nor is there one to fixing the plight of Michigan cities. For example, the Michigan Turnaround Plan identifies over 80 actions that could be taken to accelerate our state's economy. Similarly, this report identifies many actions that will be needed to accelerate growth in our cities and metro regions. The strategy provides a framework to guide state urban strategy and principles to guide local redevelopment efforts. Like the Michigan Turnaround Plan, as Jim mentioned, this is a strategy that's based on facts and on the existing strengths and assets of our metro areas. As the report concludes, we also have a solid footing to grow on. There are several points that I wanted to emphasize about the report before we conclude today. First is, we are really pleased to see that this report reflects the importance of manufacturing to our state. It's been our strength, and instead of running from it, we should be embracing it and helping it grow. It won't produce all the jobs that we need, but we know that we can't grow the innovation jobs that we want without a strong manufacturing base. I also want to underscore the challenges that metro regions face in the way federal and state programs are organized. Bruce mentioned that briefly in his talk. Since we recognize that our metro areas drive economic growth, it's important that the flow of federal and state funds and the delivery of services are more aligned with how metro regions actually look. Michigan already has 3,000 units of government. I think you'll agree we don't need to make things any more complicated by layering different program boundaries on top of that structure. Business Leaders for Michigan partnered with the West Michigan Strategic Alliance last year in an effort to try to simplify and better align the geographic boundaries of many different government programs and services. And you can see from the slides just how unaligned our government programs are today with the state's natural economic regions, using Grand Rapids as an example. Frankly, we had hoped that the state had more power to fix the problem, but they don't. Most of the boundaries are set by the federal government. So the recommendation in this report to seek federal waivers, especially to align federal workforce programs, is especially important. The good news is that the governor and his administration is already on a path to tackle some of these difficult obstacles. As Bruce mentioned, he has already mentioned many of these in the different messages he's made over the past year. Last, I want to emphasize the smallest section of the report, but the one that might be the most important to sustaining long-term growth in our cities and regions, and that is the need to build on the basics. We strongly believe that a holistic approach is needed to growing our urban areas, just as we believe is the case for the state. The first three steps of our turnaround plan are focused on fixing the state's basics, adopting good management practices, structurally balancing the budget, along with improving the delivery of state services, and providing a competitive business environment. Our goals for prioritizing state investments come after those three steps, because if you don't have a solid foundation, your investments won't have as good a return and your economy won't grow as much as it should. The basics are the foundation upon which all the strategies Bruce talked about are built. As citizens, it's what we should expect, and at the same time, we should support elected leaders who are focusing on these as their top priorities. So it's critical that our cities and urban areas focus on sound fiscal management, ethics standards, effective public safety, results-oriented redevelopment strategies, cost-effective and reliable basic services, and support regional solutions to problems. The recommendations in this report are good ones. They offer solid steps that can be taken to help our cities and metro regions grow. But if our communities cannot deliver the basics and do them well, then the other actions aren't going to achieve the results we all want. We're hopeful that this report will serve as a guide for our state and for our cities as they try to help us grow our economy. Thanks very much.
Okay, well, thank you, gentlemen. I'd like to start the questioning with the final point about this role of city and county governments in the metro areas. Obviously, the weak link in all of our metro areas is the fiscal condition of city and county government. Sure. So how big a roadblock is that? Are there workarounds? What do we do about that?
Well, I mean, one of the things I think, you know, John, that we're dealing with right now is the role that this new Emergency Financial Management Act plays in this effort. I mean, I think that what we tried to say in this report is we want to do everything we can to avoid that situation whenever possible. And we outlined some principles in the report that we think are good guideposts, I think, for local governments to use to stay away from those situations. But the fact is that, you know, we are where we are. And so we would say for a place like Detroit, for example, there are so many good things going on right now that it's this fiscal cloud that kind of hangs over our head. And the quicker we can get that out of the way, the better.
Okay, and Bruce, you see this?
It's a tale of two cities in many respects. And I was in Washington, D.C. when there was a federal takeover in the mid-1990s. And that was done to stabilize the city finances and get the city back on track from a regulatory and administrative perspective. In the past 15 years, that city has come back because the basics were fixed and you were allowed to have sort of a flourishing of market forces, business, residential, et cetera, that really served a broad portion of the population. So Detroit right now, enormous amount of national media focusing on the city finances. What I think this report tries to say is there are enormous assets in this city and there are enormous strengths of this metropolis that you can really build on, and fixing those basics will enable that to happen at a much more rapid rate.
Jim, your business is in the city.
It is. Yep. Yeah, I think the point to be made is from business leaders is that we are optimistic. You know, last couple of weeks ago, we rolled out a reset of this plan, and in that, You know, we believe with McKinsey's help and, again, database, that we can add 500,000 new jobs in this state in the next 10 years. But it's a matter of getting the basics right, you know, that simple thing of not spending more than you take in, that somehow we need to build that deeper into our thinking.
Okay. In terms of our new economy, there's an interesting thing I've noticed about our business accelerators, which exist in a lot of places. A lot of the companies coming out of those are not automotive-related or sort of old economy-related. They're healthcare, digital technology. So what's the relationship between the new economy and the old economy?
Well, I think there's a very close relationship. I mean, it's hard to say that lingo or lexicon really applies in many respects. Because, again, what we find is that the manufacturing sector of this economy, the national economy, automotive, aerospace, defense, medical devices, pharmaceuticals, is the most innovative sector of the economy in many, many respects. We still tend to think about manufacturing as if it's 30 years ago, when it's the most technologically sophisticated sector we have. And guess what? The jobs are here. We're not just generating the ideas in the United States and offshoring to China or to other parts of Asia or to other parts of the world. We're generating ideas here, and we're applying that at home. And once you have that interplay of ideas and the commercialization of ideas, the application of ideas, and the prototyping of products and the mass production of products, you have a workforce that is earning decent wages so they can go out and do what everyone wants to do, buy a home, save for their retirement, put their children through college. I would argue that for too long in this country and probably in this state, we have dismissed the quote-unquote old economy while focusing on the new economy. And if anyone read the New York Times piece a couple weeks ago about where iPods are manufactured, that should tell us that we need to rethink our growth model. So I think the healthcare sector and the other sectors you identified have an enormous potential to be productive and innovative in this country, both to serve individuals, but to also provide a good job space. But so does this advanced industry set of clusters and sectors, which, frankly, you have a platform in this state.
Yeah. Doug,
I would just, you know, share what Bruce said. I mean, I think it's something that we have really in Michigan. I think you're right, Bruce. I mean, I think we really almost kind of had a feeling like we had to run away from this sector because it is volatile. It has had some ups and downs, and I think diversification in and of itself is not a bad thing to do, but not at the expense of losing what is a core strength of our state. I mean, if you look at the core assets that we took the last year, as Jim mentioned, to identify for Michigan, virtually all of those core assets have their roots in our manufacturing heritage or our key manufacturing sectors. And so for us as a state to walk away from those is also walking away from the 500,000 new jobs that we've estimated we could create in Michigan on top of our normal growth, by the way, which seems like a bad strategy.
Yeah, Jim, you're in the chemical business. Is that new economy or old economy?
Well, if your iPod works, it's new economy because I make a very parts per trillion pure sulfuric acid so that your iPad works. So that's new economy. If you're tanning leather for your shoes, it's old economy. But the point is that the innovation is driven because you're manufacturing. This notion that somehow we're going to get wealthy by each one of us giving somebody else a haircut, being totally in the service business, is folly. And we need manufacturing, and because Bruce's point is so well taken. The link between innovation and manufacturing is rock solid.
Yeah, and what's the typical education levels a manufacturing worker in your business would need now?
Well, certainly an associate's degree, but you know, we hire a lot of engineers, a lot of chemists, so those are advanced degrees in many cases.
Okay, now we touched on immigration. Is that, Bruce, is that a getting more highly educated, highly motivated immigrants here, is that a federal policy only, or are there things that we can do here?
It's partly a federal policy because the federal government has to set the rules for the nation on immigration. But there are many things a state can do to be a welcoming environment, both generally in its community, but also in the higher ed research institutions and the community colleges where many of these foreign-born individuals are coming. Let's just make it as plain as we can. Immigration and diversity is a strength of this country. It is a platform for growth going forward. We are the most diverse nation in the world, and immigrants today will be the entrepreneurs tomorrow, and they will trade back, in many respects, to the countries they came from. So we are positioned in the United States more than any European country, and frankly, more than China, India, and Brazil, to have a good run of growth off of this incredibly diverse base. But that means we need to show a face to the world that is open and welcoming.
Yeah, we really should. If, you know, we bring these folks in, we train them, we give them advanced degrees, and we make them go home. I mean, we're crazy. The reality is we ought to be stapling a green card on every advanced degree and say, welcome, stay here and use your energies in America.
Yeah. In the last few years, we have done a lot to promote the new economy. We've started all these accelerators. Just in the last few years, Ann Arbor Spark, I think, is 5 years old or so.
Right, sure.
Tech Town's about 5 years old. The University Research Corridor, which is one of your initiatives, is a couple of years old. So we're still in the early stages of this, right? How far along are we in developing, quote, the new economy?
Well, I mean, again, I guess to go back to the earlier answer, which is that I think a lot of the new economy is, first of all, the old economy. And if you look at most of the businesses, for example, that are coming out of these accelerators so far, is most of them actually are in fields like life sciences or in advanced manufacturing. And actually, the number that are in information technology, which you'd probably classify as new economy, are actually a minority of the enterprises. And if you look at the ones that have the highest valuation, they're also in the, quote, old economy sectors of life sciences, advanced manufacturing. So, and we know this because we have a venture capital fund, Business Leaders for Michigan, does that invest in a lot of those companies. So I think it just buttresses what, you know, Bruce has been talking about, which is there is this old distinction we have really doesn't apply very well anymore.
Yeah, there was this notion somehow that the United States was going to build a post-industrial economy. And frankly, it's nonsense. Any country that gives up its production base is really on a road to ruin. And we were headed there, frankly. We began to basically subsidize consumption and basically reward speculation. I think this recession was a wake-up call to the country. And I think, you know, whether it's corporate leaders like Jeff Immelt of General Electric or Andrew Leveris of Dow Chemical, we finally are hearing voices from the production group of business leaders in concert with financial institutions to say we need to take a different path forward. All we're saying in this report, if any state is going to have a productive, innovative, and export-oriented future, it should be the state of Michigan. You can literally see Canada from Detroit, right? So you're poised at the state level and at the city and metro level to lead the shift back to a productive and innovative economy. It would be nice to have a national government, but we're not going to wait.
Okay.
Good stuff on that.
As we're about to go to the questions from the audience on the blue cards, but let me just ask, in terms of best practices and who's got it right, Bruce, you travel a lot overseas. Maybe
right.
We all do, but who's doing it right, and where do we rank kind of generally in terms of getting our act together here?
Well, the first place we should look is Germany. Mm-hmm. Germany is in the heart of Europe. 20% of their jobs, 21% of their jobs are in manufacturing. They're an export powerhouse. And it's not just because of their tax system. It's because they're investing in workers. Voc-Ed, career and technical services, the equivalent of community colleges, and frankly, the support for this virtuous interplay between technological advancement, product innovation, and process innovation in manufacturing firms. So Germany has built a platform that we can emulate and, more importantly, tailor and adapt to our own culture and our own economy. But that would be the first place I would look, because we want to look to
a place that's similar. And I think you've got to look to either Europe or Japan, and I would say Germany is the place.
Any U.S. cities that really have their act together?
I think what is happening post-recession is we are having governors and mayors, and more importantly, their business, civic, and university allies begin to shift towards this model. I'll give you just one example. If we went to New York City 7 years ago, and you asked anyone in New York City, what's the most important economic development initiative in that state, they would tell you it was a stadium on the west side of Manhattan. I wasn't that supportive of that, but in any event, that was the big economic development initiative. 7 years later, what's the most important development initiative? To attract a world-class engineering school to Roosevelt Island to provide a platform for productive and innovative and export-oriented growth, which Mayor Bloomberg has done with Cornell and Technion University out of Israel. In 7 years, you've gone from a parasitic kind of investment to a catalytic investment. The whole country needs to move in this direction.
Good. And Jim and Doug, briefly, what's one thing that we have done that we really did right, do you think, in the last few years in terms of moving us along? What are you most proud of?
Jim, you want to start?
Oh, I think fixing the business taxes. First thing. I mean, you've got to get the ground zero right, and we had the worst one in the country, and so now we're giving, all the S-corps, all the partnerships don't pay any tax. I'm a C-corp, so I'm paying tax, but as a group, we've done exactly the right thing. We're in a position to attract business now.
You know, I think what I'd say is that I think we're beginning to realize that there's only one state, and we're all in this together, and the divides that have really hurt our state's ability to move forward in the past, the east-west, Detroit suburbs, all those issues, and not that they're all fixed, but I see at least in the last 3 or 4 or 5 years just dramatic improvement in terms of us working together as a community on one plan, one vision, one direction, and I think that's going to be our biggest strength going forward.
Good. You do see more cooperation between universities, foundations, corporations, private public sector. A lot more of that is happening now.
You do.
Yeah. Hans Werner, I think you've got some questions for us.
Not just a few questions. Numerous questions, and apologies up front that we frankly cannot run through all the questions. So I did my best to really prioritize both fact-rich questions and hopefully also some questions which all of you have been looking for. We talked quite a bit about job creation, especially manufacturing jobs. So what can we specifically do to create manufacturing jobs in Michigan? Question to all.
Bruce. Well, I would think first and foremost off of building from your rich network of major global companies and the entire supply chain. There's always a focus at times of let's bring in that firm with 3,000 jobs. This is the way the southern states have mostly operated. I think your state's in a different position. You've got a rich platform here. You've got to talk to your manufacturing, small, medium, and large, and say, what do you need? What I hear, number one, is skilled workers. A large number of your firms have workers that are going to reach the retirement age in the next 3 or 5 years, right? So you've got to have a feeder network coming out of your high schools and your community colleges and your skilled intermediaries to fill those jobs. Because that's the platform for growth going forward. One other thing about manufacturing, it's really about industry. It's not just the jobs on the factory floor. It's the jobs in the research institutes that are developing the ideas, and then it's the trade and logistics jobs at your air hubs, at your rail hubs, at your ports. This is the gift that keeps on giving. For every manufacturing job, the multiplier effect is as good, if not better, than any other sector of the economy. So build off your base. Don't try to be someone else. Don't be fanciful about your future. You have a rich, productive platform here, incredible network of advanced research institutions. Get about the business of strengthening it.
And I would just add one thing, Hans Werner, to that, which is to recognize that manufacturing is part of the future.
Absolutely.
I mean, just the mindset of not thinking of it as being the past and the old is a change from where we are today.
And Business Leaders right now has got a program where we're focusing on doing business with Michigan companies. In other words, we can uptick the business by just paying more attention to what businesses are located in Michigan. And if we can and they're competitive and it makes sense, we do business with Michigan companies.
Question for Bruce. We talked about regional collaboration. What are the best practices you have seen for regional collaboration between private sector, university, government?
I mean, I think you could go to a place like Denver, where the central city, 40 municipalities, doesn't sound like a lot in the Northeast and the Midwest, but still, to Denver, it's a lot, have come together with their business, civic, and university leaders around transformative investments. Governor Hickenlooper of Colorado, former mayor of Denver, likes to say, collaboration is the new competition. The city of Denver is not competing with the surrounding counties. The metropolitan area of Denver is competing with the rest of the country and the rest of the world. So come together, understand what your assets are, understand you want to build on those assets, and you want to be world class. In Denver, what they did is they went back to the voters. They got them to pass a sales tax. They're building a 118-mile light rail system with the bulk of the funding coming from the city and metropolis. They're not waiting for the feds. They're not waiting for Godot. They're getting it done themselves. Collaboration is the new competition across these different sectors, across jurisdictions, across disciplines.
Thank you. Question touching on our education system. Is the emphasis on immigration a direct correlation to the poor results of our educational system? A little bit of a loaded question, obviously.
I think we have to walk and chew gum at the same time. We have to upgrade the education and skills of our native workforce. And it is critical. It's critical in pre-K, K through 12, community colleges, and various skilled intermediaries, and we can do it. I've been to high schools around this country, high schools oriented, frankly, towards manufacturing and production, where kids will come in with third grade reading and third grade math in some of the poorest and most deprived neighborhoods of their city and walk out with credentials to go on a factory floor into a firm and make $50,000 a year or move on to community college or beyond. We've got to do both. We've got to do both because this is a new global economic order. It is not sufficient just to grow our own workforce. It is absolutely essential for us to be the one nation that every talented worker in the world wants to come to realize their dreams, and to ultimately engage further with their own country of origin.
Thank you, Chris. Shifting gears a little bit to the urban development theme, what is the most important thing Lansing or our administration in Lansing can do to really stimulate growth in the Michigan cities in the 14 metro areas, Bruce, which you alluded to, and I think also a question for Jim and Doug?
Well, I would say I have a different view of the U.S. probably than the textbook. You know, if you read the textbook, it's the federal government is on top, then we have our union of states, and somewhere in the bottom, not recognized in the Constitution, is our cities and metropolitan areas. I flip that and basically say, well, since the cities and metropolitan areas are driving the entire economy, frankly, driving the global economy, what if our state governments and perhaps our national government ultimately came behind the visions and the particular, the distinctive and unique strategies of cities and metropolitan areas? As we did this report with business leaders and public sector consultants, we pulled together cities and metropolitan leaders from around the state, and they all came in, Flint, Grand Rapids, Lansing, Ann Arbor, Detroit, with very clear sense of their possibilities. So what I would say to the state government is recognize and embrace those local visions and get behind them. Mm-hmm. In Detroit, it might be this incredible urban innovation district that you're building in the downtown through the corridor up to the midtown. It'll be something different in Flint. It'll be something different in Grand Rapids. But let the cities and metros lead in policy making and application of policy, because they are the engines of your economy. And so it's flip the pyramid, get behind these places in advance of their distinct visions.
You know, in a way, Hans Berner, to kind of tie it back to the turnaround plan, I mean, one of the things that we've said to state government in general is they need to do a better job of prioritizing the use of our limited resources across the board. And in particular, for our metro and urban communities, that's needed. We have in the past, as Bruce pointed out in this report, is we have tended to kind of peanut butter spread the limited dollars we've had in Michigan to hundreds of communities rather than saying, geez, you know, rather than doing a little bit well everywhere, why don't we do really well in a fewer set of areas? And I think that's a powerful recommendation and one that really links well to what we ought to do with the state budget in general.
I really agree with Doug. I mean, we have spread the resources too widely. We haven't focused on our real strengths, and that's what we need to do.
You briefly mentioned the Michigan Turnaround Plan and also the new Michigan Growth Strategy. How does the new Michigan strategy developed by business leaders for Michigan fit in that overall context, including urban development?
Well, the first of all, our new Michigan the turnaround plan in general recognizes for state government what it needs to do to accelerate growth. And in many ways, you can take all six steps and apply them to urban and metro areas in virtually the same order. But more particularly, our focus on what Michigan can be in the future is totally asset-based and asset-driven. And that's what Bruce has been talking about here today, is to build on the natural assets, existing assets that we already have in Michigan, to grow the future economy. He mentioned earlier about the southern states and what their strategy has been to grow. They had to use those strategies of going after 3,000-person smokestack-chasing industries because they didn't have the assets that we have. And so looking at it as a, you know, an outsider, you look at Michigan and you say, we've got it. We're already there. We just have to do a better job at focusing the resources and time and energy we spend on leveraging those assets rather than dispersing out and going after things that aren't in our state.
Yeah, the six pillars that we built in this new Michigan plan, engineering, biotech, transportation, mobility, all of those are key to our future, but we've thought them through. We're open. I mean, we don't think that this is, you know, that somehow we have a direct line to what's right. But we've gone to the facts, and this is the way we see it. We're open to anybody's input in terms of what they think we could do to do better. Our overall goal is to make Michigan a top 10 state in terms of economic growth, job growth, personal income growth. We were there once. We lost our way. We're trying to find our way back.
Final question, and I've chosen to select a question from a student in Detroit. How is my future as a student in Detroit to get a steady office job?
Steady office job.
First of all, there won't be an office job. I mean, he needs to be rigorous in terms of his education. He needs to demand from his education system, whether it be Detroit Public Schools or charter schools or wherever he's going to school, that he is not just being passed along, but is really being educated so that he's ready to go to junior college or a university so he can get a job in the new economy, in the new manufacturing economy, which requires far greater skills than have been there in the history.
I would say that individuals obviously have to take responsibility for their own education and skills. The question for the country and for the state is whether we're going to be smart enough and strategic enough to ensure that we are creating the kind of not just more jobs, but better jobs, jobs that really pay decent wages. We went off track in this country for 25 years, in my opinion. We embraced a growth model, which put consumption and debt and innovating in the wrong things over what we know are the fundamentals. Production, innovation, exports, global engagement, that's the path back to prosperity, not just for the country, but for individuals. So as students prepare themselves and do what they have to do, our country's leadership has to do what it has to do to make sure that we have the kind of jobs that are going to pay them good wages, provide good benefits, and build back a middle class in this country.
And maybe one last idea is make your own job. Don't think that you're going to have to go work for necessarily an employer. You be the employer. If you've got a great idea, if you come up with a great, you know, way of doing things, that's the American way. Be an entrepreneur.
Great closing, Doc. Thank you very much. Thank you, gentlemen.
Gentlemen, thank you so much. Very interesting, and I know the people on this side of the room are probably going to leave and join that party over there, whatever's going on next door. But seriously, Jim, thank you so much. Bruce, you traveled from Washington, D.C. Thank you very much, Doug. Really appreciate it. John, great job moderating. Hans Werner, excellent question selecting. And ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate your time today. We hope we will see you tomorrow at Ford Field. This meeting is adjourned.